that work for you?
Whatever works for you.
I am.
That's better. Before I could see only your hat.
Let's head this way.
So let's go back.
It was nearly a month after this that Lucy was first introduced to Lord Lufton, and then it was brought about only by accident. During that time, Lady Lufton, that is Lord Lufton's mother, had often been at the parsonage, that is Lucy's brother's house, Mark Robart's house, and had in a certain degree learned to know Lucy, Lady Lufton, the mother of the hero, but the stranger in the parish had never yet plucked up courage to accept one of the numerous invitations that had reached her. Mr. Robarts and his wife had frequently been at Framley Court, that's Lady Lufton's house, but the dreaded day of Lucy's initiation had not yet arrived. She had seen Lord Lufton in church, but hardly so as to know him, and beyond that she'd not seen him at all. One day, however, or rather one evening, for it was already dusk, he overtook her and Mrs. Robarts on the road, walking toward the vicarage. He had his gun on his shoulder, three pointers, that is, hunting dogs, were at his heel, and a gamekeeper followed a little in the rear. "How are you, Mrs. Robarts?" he said, almost before he had overtaken them. "I've been chasing you along the road for the last half mile. I never knew ladies walk so fast. We should be frozen if we were to dawdle, as you gentlemen do." And then she stopped and shook hands with him. She forgot at the moment that Lucy and he had never met, and therefore she did not introduce them. "Won't you make me known to your sister-in-law?" he said, taking off his hat and bowing to Lucy. "I've never yet had the pleasure of meeting her, though we've been neighbors for a month and more." Fanny made her excuses and introduced them, and then they went on until they came to Framley Gate, Lord Lufton talking to them both, and Fanny answering for the two, so Lucy doesn't say anything. And there they stopped for a moment. And then it appeared that Mrs. Robarts had some engagement which made it necessary that she should go and see Lady Lufton, probably to tell her about Captain Culpepper, whereas Lucy was intending to walk on to the parsonage alone. "And I promised to go to your husband," said Lord Lufton, "or rather to your husband's dog, Ponto, and I will do two other things. I will carry a brace of pheasants with me," brace meaning two pheasants that you can put over your shoulder, "and protect Miss Robarts from the evil spirits of the Framley roads." And so Mrs. Robarts turned in at the gate, and Lucy and his lordship walked off together. Lord Lufton, though he'd never before spoken to Miss Robarts, had already found out that she was by no means plain, which everybody else says she is. Though he'd hardly seen her except at church, he had already made himself certain that the owner of that face must be worth knowing, and was not sorry to have the present opportunity of speaking to her. "So you have an unknown damsel shut up in your castle," he had once said to Mrs. Robarts. "If she be kept a prisoner much longer, I shall find it my duty to come and release her by force of arms." He'd been there twice with the object of seeing her, but on both occasions Lucy had managed to escape. Now we may say she was fairly caught. And Lord Lufton, taking a pair of pheasants from the gamekeeper, swinging them over his shoulder, walked off with his prey. Something that strikes me as of fundamental importance, and that is, always make citations. So I would study Poulet's essays about Madame de Sévigné or Baudelaire or whoever to try to figure out how he did it. Any great critic like Poulet is, you can't imitate them. But the one thing I did notice is that that his essays are structured around citation, that there's a kind of quasi-scientific. I'm going to say something about Baudelaire or whoever, but I'm going to show that what I say is true because I make citations. I remember I began as a physicist for 2 years, and I was very good at math, and considered becoming a math major when I was at Oberlin, but I was technically for the first 2 years a physics major, so I have some scientific training, and the one thing you learn from science is that you don't just say, well, black holes are made of green cheese. You get some data to prove that black holes are really made of green cheese. You don't make assertions without having evidence. Evidence often, in the case of physics, in the form of mathematical information. But you don't want to make statements about black holes without having collected some evidence, and that's the way science still works. I was just reading in the New York Times this morning an article about about 2% of scientists publish false articles. So that would be like me saying that black holes are made of green cheese, or like me saying John Caldegate is something that it really isn't. So how would you catch me out? One would be, how would I defend myself? One would be by saying, here's the passage that I'm talking about that supports the general claim I'm making. The other way would be to see whether it's reproducible. What's reproducibility in the area of the study of literature is whether other people read the novel and come up with similar readings. Now, that's where the analogy breaks down between the interpretation of literature. I'm talking about teaching it, writing about it, and talking about it generally, as we're doing now. It breaks down because the data from black holes and from, it was astrophysics I was especially interested in, but the same thing would go for nuclear physics, isn't the same thing as language. Language has got some special problems, and literature is made of language. So you can't simply transfer scientific methodology from the study of black holes or supernova or whatever to the study of literature. You have to recognize that the thing you're studying, just as scientists do, in this case language, has its own special rules and difficulties that make it very hard to get a consensus. A passage in Paul de Man's essay on Benjamin's Task of the Translator sticks in my mind as a way to formulate that. And as you know, he says, he makes a distinction based on Benjamin, on a passage in Benjamin, between the hermeneutics, what de Man calls hermeneutics and poetics. And the Benjamin is the meaning, the Gemeinte, and Artus Meinen, the way it's said, as opposed to the meaning. And de Man, in his typically challenging way, says, you might wish that you could do hermeneutics, which is concerned with what the passage means, and poetics, which is concerned with how that meaning gets said, and reconcile them. It's not at all clear that this is the case, says de Man. so that figurative language, which roughly is what he means by poetics, interferes with hermeneutics. Most of my books have come out of my teaching, like Communities in Fiction. That was from graduate seminars at Irvine over the last years. One of my tasks at Hopkins was to teach undergraduate and graduate courses. And my main task, I was the Victorianist, so I had to teach Victorian novel. And Georges Poulet had become a great friend and colleague of mine. We used to have coffee every morning in a coffee place at Hopkins and talk about this and that. But I was teaching because I thought I ought to include Trollope in my list along with George Eliot and Dickens and so on. And I chose somewhat arbitrarily because I was totally ignorant. Barchester Towers. So I was teaching Barchester Towers, I think, in an undergraduate, small undergraduate course, because the number of English majors was not large. And I complained to Poulet and said, George, I'm teaching Trollope's Barchester Towers, and I don't know what to, I don't have anything to say about it. I'm having great difficulty filling up the several hours that I'd allotted to this novel. And Poulet said, oh, Trollope. And it at that point turned out that Poulet was a great reader of Trollope, that he had read all of Trollope's novels. He taught at the University of Edinburgh. He'd read them all from one end to the other and essentially knew them by heart. The main thing I remember, but it's important still for me, was his notion that Trollope's novels express the, he didn't use the terminology of the narrator, express what he called a collective consciousness of a community. A fascinating idea, and one that I would now be a little dubious about, though it does describe something, I think, for him. And the narrator, according to him, of Trollope's novel, speaks for that collective consciousness. So the consciousnesses of all the characters, remember, consciousness is the big term for Poulet. He's a critic of consciousness. All of the characters' minds are embedded in that collective consciousness. And it's that that justifies, according to, or explains, according to Poulet, another key term in his reading of Trollope, the transparency of the characters to one another, a kind of intuitive understanding of what the other person is saying. I would qualify that by saying that these late novels, especially ones I've been reading, the characters do not know what the other person, it's there to some degree, and you get notations that say he knew exactly what she was thinking from various clues and so on. But I think that idea of transparency was, in Poulet's case, exaggerated. But it made me realize that there was really something to do with teaching and understanding Trollope. So it was a decisive moment in my understanding. To me, that two of the greatest teachers that I've had, neither of whom was a Trollope specialist, Bongiorno and Poulet as a colleague teacher, were great Trollope fanatics, I would have to say. I mean, imagine that. Somebody who read through all of Trollope's novels, and ever since then I've been trying to understand Trollope and reading more of his novels and writing about him now and then. But for a Poulet, he said something interesting. He said, I've read all of those Trollope's novels. Trollope is very important for me, but I've never had the idea of writing about him. You've been here a long time, he said, without our having had the pleasure of seeing you. Yes, my lord, said Lucy. Lords had not been frequent among her acquaintance hitherto. I'll tell Mrs. Robarts that she's been confining you illegally and that we shall release you by force or stratagem. And she says, I've had a great sorrow lately. And he says, yes, Miss Robarts, her father has died. I know you have, and I'm only joking, you know, but I do hope that you will be able to come amongst us. My mother is so anxious that you should do so. Then we have an interchange between Lord Lufton and Lucy about her father. And remember, she's in mourning, and at this point, the narrator reflects on the fact that often we don't talk to people who are in a state of mourning for some close relative, such as your father, who would have died. And then there's a passage probably I should read because it's a long figure of speech that intervenes and is spoken by the narrator. There was once a people in some land, and they may still be there for what I know, who thought it sacrilegious to stay the course of a raging fire. A house were being burned it must, even though there were facilities for saving it. For who would dare to interfere with the course of the god? And our idea of sorrow is much the same. We think it wicked, or at any rate heartless, to put it out. If a man's wife be dead, he should go about lugubrious with a long face for at least 2 years, or perhaps with full length for 18 months, decreasing gradually during the other six. If it be a man who can quench his sorrow, put out his fire, as it were, in less time than that, let him at any rate not show his power. They turned through the parsonage gate, then towards the end now of this segment. And he says, I suppose I shall find Mark up at the house. That's Lucy's brother. That's that household that she's now moved into. He says, I dare say you will, says Lucy. I'll go around this way. You see, I'm quite at home here, though you've never seen me before. But, Miss Robarts, now that the ice is broken, I hope that we may be friends. He then put out his hand, and when she gave him hers, he pressed it almost as an old friend might have done. And indeed, Lucy had talked to him almost as though he were an old friend. For a minute or two, she'd forgotten that he was a lord and a stranger, had forgotten also to be stiff and guarded, as was her wont. Lord Lufton had spoken to her as though he really cared to know her, and she unconsciously had been taken by the compliment. Lord Lufton, indeed, had not thought much about it, excepting as thus, that he liked the glance of a pair of bright eyes, as most other young men do like it. But on this occasion, the evening had been so dark that he had hardly seen Lucy's eyes at all. The first example of a running figure that goes through the passage, which when you notice it and see that it comes back, is kind of interesting. He'd said once to Mrs. Robarts, you have an unknown damsel shut up in your castle. And then this introduced, it's a cliche from romances early 19th century Gothic novels and so on. You have a damsel shut up in your castle, Lucy. She's not. If she'd be kept a prisoner much longer, this is quoted from Lord Lufton speaking to Mrs. Robarts, I shall find it, that is the sister-in-law of Lucy, I'll find it my duty to come and release her by force of arms. And then, she's a imprisoned damsel, and he is the knight errant who's going to come and free her. It's a very powerful figure, and it's not accidental. I think I think Trollope means is to understand that's what Lord Lufton is going to do, and it's to some degree behind this is the image of the male who successfully courts the unmarried maiden, who's sort of a prisoner in her home, frees her from that into adult life and adult sexuality. And this comes out in the last sentence. Now that's I, the narrator, the authorial or narratological we may say she was fairly caught. She's been, now the figure is a little less innocent. She's not just liberated, she's caught. And Lord Lufton, taking a pair of pheasants from the gamekeeper, the picture shows him carrying them, and swinging them over his shoulder, walked off with his prey. And you say, prey? Is that the pheasants that he shot? Or is this Lucy? So there's an equivalence made between the killed pheasants, because he shot them, not the gamekeeper, and Lucy as his prey. They're both his prey. So there's some sinister, slightly sinister aspect of this courtship. And then you get the picture. I must say that though Lucy sort of looks like I imagine her to look, short, pretty, so on, Lord Lufton doesn't correspond at all to the mental image I had of Lord Lufton before I saw the picture. I didn't imagine those whiskers. I didn't imagine the clothes he's wearing and the funny hat. I would have thought that he would have been slightly younger looking. In other words, it's one of those cases where I want to say to the illustrator, you've got it all wrong. And that's an interesting moment. Nevertheless, it tells you something about how in the Victorian period, an expert illustrator imagined Lucy and Lord Lufton to look. So you have to take it seriously. Millais is, he was a very great illustrator, of course. And there are other things you can do with this. What's that birdhouse doing in the background? And the chickens on the ground behind this doorway. What was in Millais' mind? And now you could say there's a wall with a ring in it, etc. You could say, well, this is just decor. There really would have been likely to be probably a dove nest or dove house, and those they were eaten. I know this because my grandfather, maternal grandfather's barn, there was a dove cote in the top of the barn, and he would go out with his shotgun and scare them out, shoot them, and we would have them for dinner. So they're edible food, these small. In the United States, they're mourning doves. I'm not quite sure what they were eating. So once again, the image of prey, P-R-E-Y, is there, as are the chickens. So we've got three different kinds of edible birds in Millais' pictures. Very clever. And it goes beyond anything in the text, as good illustrations do, and you have to sort of look at them to figure out what's going on, and what's going on in excess of the text. A good illustrator always puts something in. So this is when he shakes hands with her, when they touch. There's a tactile relation just before they separate back at the farm. He's going to go in and help deal with Ponto, the dog, hunting dog. Ponto would have been a hunting dog, not just a pet. So, yes, I agree. And I also would I will carry a brace of pheasants with me and protect Miss Robarts from the evil spirits of the Framley roads. Very strange. It's another figure that adds into this general picture of the scene as being somehow like a Gothic novel with evil spirits, a damsel in a tower, imprisoned, the knight who comes to protect her from the evil spirits. So anybody who says that Trollope's boring or that his style is totally transparent and uninteresting hasn't read very carefully. I would like to read John Caldegate by way of a Husserlian epica, which, as you remember, means the suspend. Let's suspend everything, put it all aside, and I'm just going to try to make sense out of this novel. And I would pose this now as the question of what actually happens in my mind and feelings and body when I read John Caldegate. My answer to that, again, trying to be as concrete as I can, is that reading John Caldegate creates an imaginary world in which my mind and feelings and body cooperate. The kind of subliminal physical reactions. Well, for example, when characters kiss, I do a little kissing of my own with my body. It's not quite the same as emotions. So the answer is it's primarily people, the imagination of people and their thoughts and actions and interactions with one another, though it's also seen. So I have a vivid idea in my mind of, for example, the muddy roads and decrepit houses in Australian gold mining, because Trollope's narrator tells me a good bit about these. And I emphasize something that is very often, I think, forgotten in people who want somehow to tie novels to the real world, and that is that you can meet Caldegate, Hester, and Crinket, and all the other people in this novel nowhere but in the pages of John Caldegate. They do not exist as real people. They exist only as this virtual imaginary world that the words on the page. Now, no doubt there's some relation to the real world of that time. I wouldn't deny that. But in no sense is it a direct mirroring of people and their actions in the real world, even though real cities are mentioned. What's the mode of existence of that virtual world? What kind of thing is it? Where is it? How could I put my fingers on it? I think the answer to that is extremely strange and often forgotten. It seems to be there when I read John Caldegate somewhere, all the time, waiting to be entered whenever I pick up the book and read an e-text of the book, printed book, or an e-text. It's somewhere there. It seems to have a kind of permanent existence. And one evidence for this is that few people, certainly except Poulet, could find time or have the ability to read John Caldegate at one sitting. I certainly couldn't. I have to stop it. I have other things to do. I come back and pick it up. So it's as if it goes on happening somewhere, waiting for me to return and re-enter it at the temporal location where I had to stop reading. I go back to that page, and there it is. And I can get to it only through the words. So it exists in that strange place, since you asked about this, it made me think about it, as a temporal sequence, all right. And I'm happy with the idea that sequence has its quasi-musical rhythm. It's something that Proust particularly talked about. But it's also segments marked out as chapters and with hiatuses between that we feel the narrative voice could fill in if it wished. It just doesn't choose to tell you everything. But that the rest of it so that you get a new chapter that says 5 months later, and the narrator never tells you what happened in those 5 months. But that doesn't mean you don't think he or she or it, the narrator, could. So I emphasize this strangeness. It's really strange. And my initial decision to shift from physics to English literature at Oberlin was motivated by a curiosity about that strangeness. I've written a number of places about that. It was a very specific text, Tennyson's Tears, Idle Tears, which is a standard textbook text. It seemed to me, as a physicist and mathematician kind of person, really weird. What does he mean by saying the tears are idle? Tears from the depths of some divine despair. What does that mean exactly? You know, my idea was that language ought to have some referential meaning. I ought to be able to paraphrase it, in a sense, and I couldn't. So I'm still fascinated by that. Two books that I remember most when I was before 10 were Alice in Wonderland and Swiss Family Robinson. One of the points I make about this is that when I first read it, I thought it was real, that it was about a real place. And my mother said, no, it's not about a real place, it's a work, it's an imaginary place. And I remember being very annoyed when she showed me the name of the author. I didn't think it had an author. I thought it was sort of direct access through the words to a place that really, really did exist. This is the one with that I wrote an introduction for. That's why it's with those books. That justifies having it here. The other editions, the older ones, are somewhere else. So there it is, with a very fanciful cover that doesn't correspond to anything that I remember. No, what I really liked about it was the idea. It's like Robinson Crusoe, except it's a whole family that build this treehouse and live together. And I learned from that novel, among other places, to have a kind of confidence that if I were marooned in the woods, I would just build myself a hut, I would find things to eat, et cetera, et cetera. And I was trained by my father as a hiker. He was a great fisherman and a great hiker, and I learned not to be afraid of the woods. Thoreau's response was, I think, a more American one, more a little like my feeling about the deserts in California. He looked at the rocks up there. He came up from the west. Their trail, there are four or five different trails up there, and he came up that. In fact, it's still called the Thoreau Trail. And what he reports on is his feeling that the rocks are completely inhuman and alien and have no sympathy whatsoever for human beings. And I think that's a more American reaction to the wilderness. what strikes me and struck me when I first read John Caldergate was, and other of Trollope's colonial novels, is the way in which he assumes that it will be quite easy to impose European, or specifically British, customs, habits, ways of thinking, ways of behaving, and so on these alien places like Australia. Now, I'm going to make one more step, and then I think, this is the question of what's the central issue in John Caldergate. What's it really about? And my answer is that it's not really about historical or political background or the class or gender structure or such, even though you learn a lot about those tacitly. The question is, who, over and over in Trollope's novels, who will marry the unmarried maiden and father children on her who will inherit whatever the father possesses? That's what really interests Trollope in his novels, whatever he was interested in. So that you might say the unmarried maiden, the young girl that James said Trollope made his big subject, big topic. He turned her inside out, the English girl. He gives all sorts of examples of her, and so he was right about that. The question that the community, fathers, mothers, uncles, aunts, friends, and so on, are, without saying so much, what they're fascinated by is the question, who is she going to marry? That's the big deal, because she's a kind of wild card at this point. And of course, the parents and aunts and uncles and so on make a lot of effort to determine whom she marries, because a lot is at stake. So his subject is courtship and marriage and the passing on from generation to generation of property, money, titles, and standing in the world. Mary Wortle in Dr. Wortle's school will become a duchess and the mother of an earl because Carstairs happened to fall in love with her. John Caldergate will inherit his father's estate after all, and his first son will, by primogeniture, inherit after him, with Hester Bolton in her obstinacy as the crucial link. And that would be the additional thing to say, Trollope's young girls are amazingly stubborn. Because they very often, and again, novel after novel, not just John Caldergate or Dr. Wortle's school, have to stick to a love commitment against total opposition from everybody. Everybody says this is a horrible mistake. And in the case of Hester Bolton, it's a horrible mistake because the guy you married happens to have been married already. The courts have said so. But there are many, many versions of this, usually having to do with class. You would marry beneath you if you chose such and such a person. So you might say the unnamed center, since it was something Victorian novels couldn't really talk about, it can't be spoken of directly but only indirectly, is the sexual intercourse between lawfully married couple that will beget the next generation and their inheritance. It's the redistribution of property, wealth, status, titles, and so on. And what determines the choice of the good girls in Trollope is falling in love. And as you know, if you've read my Ayala essay, falling in love is something you might say that's the God term, being in love, in Burke's sense, along with gentlemen, because it's indefinable. The moment when it happens is you can't really talk about it. There's a moment when they're not in love, and then there's a moment when they are. And both for men and women, it applies to both, not only these maidens, but also to men, and all they can say is, I love her or him. And the good girls stick to that choice, which in a way is not made by them. It's made by some inaccessible part of them. So you don't say, I decide that I will love John Caldegate. It just happens. Once it happens, for the good people, it's absolutely irrevocable. It's going to last for their lifetime. They were the person who were not in love with anybody, was not, and now they are the person who's in love with John Caldegate. And that's why it's on that basis that they are so annoyingly stubborn, obstinate. You remember all the efforts to get Hester back with her mother for the best reasons. You shouldn't live in proximity to somebody who is such a sinner, et cetera, et cetera. And she says, no, I'm married to him. I don't care whether he's a bigamist. I'm totally, he's bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. And that's part of the pleasure of reading Trollope's novels, is the pleasure of that obstinacy. Well, I will make the final point very briefly, and that is, so what? Everybody accepted what I've said, isn't entering the imaginary community of John Caldegate still a waste of time in our present dire? Have I really defended reading the novel? And my answer would be partly a reference to the famous passage about ideology in Paul de Man's Resistance to Theory, where he says, what we call ideology is precisely the confusion of linguistic with material reality of reference with phenomenalism. Namely, ideology is a lie. In other words, it looks like referential language, but it doesn't refer to anything. Like the verdict that says John Caldegate was guilty of bigamy. It's a reference. It's linguistic. It just doesn't happen to correspond to phenomenalism, meaning, I think, the real world, the outside real world. And then the man makes this very counterintuitive claim. It follows that more than any other mode of inquiry, including economics, the linguistics of literariness, by which he means rhetorical reading, study of figurative language, is a powerful and indispensable tool in the unmasking of ideological aberrations, as well as a determining factor in accounting for their occurrence, not only identifying ideological mistakes, but also explaining how they come about, namely by the workings of figurative of the linguistics of literariness. Those who reproach literary theory, says the man, for being oblivious to social and historical, that is to say, ideological reality, and that's a reproach often made in the old, not so easy to make anymore, of Deman or Derrida or me, not being interested in history and real social conditions. Those who reproach literary theory for being oblivious to social and historical, that is to say, ideological reality, are merely stating their fear at having their ideological mystifications exposed by the tool they are trying to discredit. In other words, they're afraid of theory because it might tell the truth about their own illusions. And then this amazing sentence, which we could spend another couple of days unraveling, they are, such people, in short, very poor readers of Marxist German ideology. It's almost the only reference the man makes to Marx. And the obvious question would be, how did the man read the German ideology? And why bring Marx in at this point? I think the answer is that Marx's German Ideology, which is an amazing book, demonstrates that ideology is based on linguistic mistakes. That's really what Marx was saying. That's a very shorthand way of talking about it. So I would argue that you can learn from reading John Caldegate in a very concentrated way how collective ideological mistakes, in this case, the whole community thinks Caldegate was a bigamist, and how the performative power of lies may have big consequences. And it also teaches you that this happens especially when those lies are promulgated through the media, the metropolitan press, meaning the London Times, but also other less reputable journals for Trollope, Fox News, radio talk shows for us. And an obvious example, you don't have to go far, many people in the United States and elsewhere who believe that Barack Obama is a Muslim Kenyan, not born in the United States, which is a requirement to be president of the United States, or so-called birthers. We need to see your birth certificate. He was born in Hawaii and therefore is an American citizen. Or even believe, quite a few people, that he's the Antichrist. There's a large percentage of American evangelical Republicans who think he's the Antichrist come back to earth. Just as Mrs. Bolton believes John Caldegate is an emissary straight from the devil, and that's a big feature of John Caldegate, the analysis of religious fanaticism in Mrs. Bolton. And she's shown us sympathetically in the sense that she's doing what she thinks is right. And so are many such people in the United States. Another example is those people still who believe against all the evidence that humanly caused climate change is a hoax, that it's concocted by the scientists to fool people, or those who believe in a false analogy between household finances, which you're taught don't get over your head in debt, and national finances. Very powerful argument for saying the debt is the big national debt is disastrous. They're not the same. They're not the same, partly because the government prints the money, and that you can't say that of any household. And final, and I have done the whole thing, it's also important to remember that just unmasking, the man's word, ideological delusions, which I would say teaching John Caldegate would be a big help in teaching students to learn how to read the media, it by no means cures you. Or anyone else of those mistaken beliefs. Just to know that the manifold linguistic mistakes that have led to continuing the burning of fossil fuels has brought about irreversible climate change doesn't keep it from going on happening.
Hi, Hillis.
Hi, Gabby.
How are you?
I'm fine.
It's so sad that we can't have you here in person, but
well,
see all this electronic technology, at least we can see you.
Well, I'm seeing actually now, because of the camera, I'm seeing just the top of your head.
Oh, now I don't even know. See, I don't know what to do it, and I don't try to.
Now I can see you better. Yeah.
I don't think universities ought to be run by very highly paid non-academic people. How do they know what ought to be taught? And they're likely to go in for MOOCs. I'm not entirely against MOOCs, by the way. And that would lead me, as you know what they are, in case whoever's watching this, massive open online courses. These are courses that are taught with the computer, and they're massive in the sense that people all over the world, so you can have 1,000, 2,000, 500,000 students for one course, series of lectures given by a distinguished professor. I think that to some degree that'll put ordinary professors out of business. I mean, why, if I can take a course with the great Shakespeare professor at Harvard and pay very little for it, why should I take a course with the much less important and gifted teacher in my own university? Do we, and that the next step beyond that is to say, do we really need that local professor at all? But what I would say about this is a general, this is Miller's law. It's the law of technological development. It's like those drones. MOOCs are like drones in the following way. Once you can do it with the new digital technology, it's irresistible. It will happen. So it's all very well for me to say, oh, I think MOOCs are a terrible idea. That's not going to stop them from happening. And that's interesting. The technological advances, particularly in the area of telecommunications, are unstoppable. I don't know why that is, but I can be sure it is. I mean, it's all very well for me to say, well, I don't use Facebook, but I can't get along without email at this point. I'm dependent on it. And so the computer has completely transformed my professional life. Even though I was to some degree, at any rate, resistant of it. So there's Miller's law. And I think it means the end of the university as we've known it gradually. The university, which depended on an earlier stage of technology. I'm not sure that if I were a young person now entering the profession, I wouldn't become a specialist in computer games, because they have such a tremendous social power and importance, and they are analyzable. They are a genre which has tremendous worldwide influence. Millions and millions of people play Grand Theft Auto, and there is beginning to be serious study of computer games, video games. There's certainly a lot of language around, so you do need in the broad sense, the ability to read, to understand, to political speeches or news reports and so on, the language part of it. But yes, I agree. I'm not sure part of the point of that essay of mine about multimedia is that it's always been multimedia, as we know with Trollope's novels. You've needed an ability to read pictures. Though I don't deny that there's a difference between reading pictures and reading text, I think also some of the same skills are, and I remember the passage in Paul the Man where he says, instead of paying attention to the visual aspect of text, we need to learn to read pictures. And I think what he meant by that was to have a sharp eye out for the way pictures, advertising, for example, but also news commentary and all of the other things that we have, make use of what are in fact in their pictures tropes. In other words, it's very valuable to recognize, and there's nothing new about this. People who wrote about cinema earlier observed that the one of the basic tools of cinema is metonymy. You put two things side by side, and the viewer assumes that there's some kind of relation between them. And it's helful to have the word metonymy to say this is. I know what this is. It's the trope called metonymy. It goes way back to the famous Potemkin thing where you have the maggots and then the crowd side by side. So you say, you know, the crowd is somehow like the maggots. And if I'm not mistaken, you all plan to juxtapose things that I say with pictures of the lighthouse or drone pictures of the house, et cetera. And this will be, you will be using a figurative expression. And to decipher that, there's nothing particularly sinister about being able to do this, although sometimes it does it does involve things that are trying to be put over on you. And that leads me to something you were going to ask me at some point about surveillance. And I do think it's worth recognizing in the novels, it's maybe a strong word for it, that generally speaking, putting aside those passages like the one you mentioned, the characters are not shown as aware that any consciousness is introspecting them. So it's really weird. It's as though you and I and all of the people here were being surveilled at this very moment by some kind of consciousness that might write it all down. And that would be, traditional Western thinking, that would have to be God. God knows what you're thinking, et cetera, et cetera. That would support the omniscient idea. Trollope never really quite says that, telepathy would be better. It's as though there was some medium that knows what, and by using the term surveillance with its negative connotations, I was meaning to call attention to how strange that is. And for me, counterfactual, I don't really think there is, certainly not any kind of secular consciousness that is surveilling everything. So here I am, apparently just sitting here talking to somebody who's not visible in the, who can see me, but who is not seen in the, it's in the privacy of my home. I'm sitting in a chair in my living room. So the whole thing is peculiar, and you might define it as a kind of a whole-scale invention of invasion of privacy and a kind of surveillance. I'm being surveilled in ways that are hidden, for example, by not showing pictures of the cameras. You're supposed to forget that such a thing exists. So we're engaged in something that is both very modern and just slightly spooky. And your team's use of drones makes that even more obvious. drones play an increasing role in industries as diverse as real estate. You take a picture of the building that you're trying to sell, and journalism, weather forecasting, and agriculture. They identify forest fires, pipeline leaks, and so on. And all of this is done by way of a tremendous surveillance capacity, which we saw in action yesterday. The owners of those lobster boats didn't ask to have their picture taken, but the picture was taken. And our pictures were also taken by the drone. The drone came down. I could see the little eye pointed in my direction. So the unmanned drones have participated in the sort of total data collection these days, at least in the United States, that takes privacy away. And I just wanted to reflect, but to say that what we're doing here looks innocent. We're going to take a lot of pictures of Hillis Miller and as he lives. Who would not be interested in that? It has no sinister purpose, but it's part of a larger operation. And I just happened to read this this morning, and I wanted to reflect on what we're doing, that it's not entirely innocent. So you want me to read this passage?